The fire started when a tree branch fell on power lines, causing them to spark and begin this fire.
Officials reported no open flames, but said the danger is far from over.
You see right now hand crews are coming in here to make sure that the smoldering hot spots are wetted down, and we want to make sure that this fire is put down before the gusts of winds start from the Santa Ana.
Those Santa Ana winds are feared to be the most significant wind event of the year, peaking in the overnight hours.
It does take one ember, just one ember downwind, to start another brush fire.
Engines have been stationed in brush areas throughout the city. 12 homes have already been destroyed, and firefighters want to prevent any further loss. Up north in wine country, some homeowners got their first look at the devastation. Air quality around the Kincaid fire is becoming a concern, and more than 4,000 firefighters are on hand.
That fire is north of 75,000 acres. We are working hard to make sure that we secure the perimeter.
Adding to the hardship, the state's largest utility is expected to continue shutting power to as many as 3 million people in the coming days to prevent sparking more fires.
I'm out here gassing up now, and just to keep that generator going, try to keep our food cold and try not to take no more losses.
The Kincaid is burning through dry brush. There has not been a significant rainfall in the area since mid-May.
We have several big stories to get to tonight, but let's kick things off with a look at the weather. A dreary night out there as we Hey.
Testing 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
And here, oh, I, Mark Robbins. That I'm asking him?
They're multiplying, and I'm losing control. Cause the power you're supplying, it's electrifying. I got chills, they're multiplying, and I'm losing control. Cause the power.
Hey, mic check. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
We're not locked out, are we?
Yeah.
Right now from Channel 3, this is Eyewitness News.
We have several big stories to get to tonight, but let's kick things off with what else? The weather, a dreary night out there as we take a live look at the capital city on this Tuesday. It is drizzling all across Connecticut. The only bright side, at least it's not too cold out right now. Hi, everyone, and thanks for joining us tonight at 11 o'clock. I'm Erin Connolly. Tomorrow, not looking so great, but the big question on everyone's mind, how is Halloween looking for all of those trick-or-treaters? Bruce DePriest joining us now with more on the all-important forecast. Bruce.
Well, Erin, the good news is it's going to be mild for Halloween, but the bad news is there will be showers in the state and also increasing winds, too. Here's your trick-or-treat forecast. We're going to get right to it for Thursday evening. Temperatures in the 60s, maybe even the mid to upper 60s, approaching 70 in some spots, but we will have showers, and that breeze is going to start getting rather gusty as we go through the evening hours. Here's why we have the early warning weather alert in effect for Thursday night and Friday morning. It's not so much the rain, although there will be plenty of it. It's the wind. By 6 o'clock Thursday evening, winds gusting as high as 30 miles an hour in some parts of the state. As we go through the evening, things are really going to ramp up. Notice by midnight, we're getting winds gusting to 38, even 41 miles an hour in parts of the state, and the winds get even stronger as we get into the pre-dawn hours of Friday, with winds gusting to between 40 and 50 miles an hour. This could cause scattered power outages in parts of the state as we go into pre-dawn Friday. And then for the Friday morning commute, winds may tame down a little bit, but still gusty to between 30 and 40 miles an hour. As far as right now goes, we have some light rain and drizzle in the state. Radar is not picking up all the precipitation, but it's misty, it's damp, and it's mild out there. Temperatures are holding in the 50s. Waterbury is 54. So is Hartford. Norwich is 55, and New Haven is coming in at 56 degrees. And winds are light. Where we do have a wind, it's kind of a maritime flow. That's why we have the low overcast, the rain and the drizzle in the state. And Futurecast shows that at midnight tonight, we'll still have some light rain and drizzle, still some pockets of that as we go into the morning commute tomorrow. And then during the day, it's not going to be raining all the time, but showers may tend to fill in a little bit more as we go into tomorrow evening on into a tomorrow night. I'll talk about when the rain will be at its heaviest, and it's coming our way as we go into Halloween. I'll time that out for you with Futurecast coming up in just a matter of a few minutes.
Oh boy, Bruce, thank you very much. To campaign 2019 news now, four of the six candidates running for mayor of Hartford got together for a final debate before next week's election. The incumbent, Luke Bronin, is seeking a second term, and tonight his three challengers went after him and his administration. Channel 3's Mark Robbins joins us live now in front of City Hall. And Mark, was there any clear-cut winner there tonight?
Well, Erin, yes, there was. And keep in mind, when you have four candidates in a debate, you're going to have four winners, all of them in their own eyes. The debate format was a question and answer session with a panel of journalists and educators asking the candidates for policies and problem solving on a variety of topics. The candidates were well prepared, eager to drive home positive points, providing the answers they believe the constituents need to hear.
When I took office, we faced some of the biggest crises the city of Hartford has ever faced, you know, from being on the brink of bankruptcy to having a baseball park project that was off the rails. And we battled those crises honestly and seriously and with a view to the long term, and got Hartford moving.
I believe I got my message across to the individuals, the citizens of Hartford who can relate to me. Just someone that grew up in the community, love Hartford, love the children and families of Hartford, and still have hope that we can do better.
One of the most heated topics tonight and throughout the campaign is Hartford's public education. Dr. Lewis had the most outspoken point of view.
I believe it's the most overlooked issue. I believe that our present administration is in complete denial about the actual data that does not lie. The numbers don't lie. Our children are performing at the worst they've ever performed, but yet and still, they continue to say that the superintendent's doing a wonderful job. And
a clear-cut winner is usually in the eye and ears of the voters, although a couple of candidates have some candid thoughts.
I always believe that I come away a victor. Yeah, that's not something that I ever second-guess. Absolutely. I think I'm the Tom Brady of what I did.
I try not to be so presumptuous to think that I was the best. You know, my ego tells me I was the best, but that is for brighter minds than mine to determine. I'll wait to see what the current says.
Now, keep in mind, it was just four of the six candidates involved. Michael Downs and former Mayor Eddie Perez did not meet the qualifications to be involved in the debate, but all six are on the ballot on Tuesday, November 5th. Reporting live with the Mobile Newsroom in Hartford, Mark Robbins, Channel 3 Eyewitness News.